Coming up next on the Jeff Curley Show, if you want to sell your house, it's pretty easy to find out the relative worth to the market. But what happens if you're trying to sell your business? You're going to want to talk to a business valuator. That's next.
Many are predicting that the worst is yet to come, which is unfortunate, said one person here. Until now, they've enjoyed the reputation of being the nation's icebox.
Watched a burglar in his home this morning by webcam.
As a journalist of over 25 years, stories are what make my world turn.
Reporting live from the Dallas newsroom tonight, Jeff Curley, Fox 4 News.
But in 2008, I took the jump from my familiar life and started a PR firm from my home.
We're talking about anyone with a camcorder like the one I'm using becomes a television network.
We started slowly growing the company, and we now have over 100 clients, and we've branched into the world of live digital broadcasting. I now own 8 different TV studios and have a huge team, and the stories that I now get to share are sometimes the most important of my life. Life has a funny way of coming around full circle. This is the Jeff Curley Show.
Well, imagine the business owner who builds a fairly large size business and he or she's coming to retirement age and they're looking to sell it. Many are in for a shock because they didn't manage the company well enough to get the valuation that they need. And sometimes it takes a guy like my next guest, Jeffrey Brewster, from Objective Valuation to come in and give the hard truth sometimes. Is that right?
Sometimes that is the case. And sometimes there's a pleasant surprise involved because the capital markets have a huge impact on a company's valuation, as does the cash flow. So there are a lot of factors at play, and that's why we want to be involved as early as possible in that decision-making process.
So ideally, if you're talking to a business owner who's considering selling, you want to catch them 3 or 4 years before they sell?
Yeah, Jeff, that's perfect timing. And what that will allow us to do is then come in and help them figure out what areas are maybe needing a little more attention and could potentially close that valuation gap. And some areas that maybe they're doing really well in, and again, try to limit that down because we empathize with that business owner. We don't, as business owners ourselves, we don't have a tremendous amount of time and all of the resources that we need. So we really have to focus in on those things that are gonna give us the biggest bang for our buck.
And often it's not just how much the company grosses each year or how much profit they have. But if the owner is too intricate to the business, it's really not worth much without the owner.
Right, right. We have a term for that. It's called personal goodwill. And that has all kinds of ramifications in a legal context where I'm being called in to be an expert witness, from a tax content as well. So personal goodwill or that key person in the business, if the business doesn't run when you go on vacation, then what we say is that there's key person risk, and that actually has a negative or adverse effect on the overall valuation, which will be determined obviously as you're going through the process. But having a good team in place that you can delegate to is really important in the overall business valuation and obviously in the continuation and the overall legacy of the company.
We were talking before we went on camera about a recycling company. So let's roll some video. This is not the actual company we're talking about, but what was that story?
Yeah, I tell people I have the best job, if you want to call it that, in the world. And I issue that challenge to people, come prove it to me, I'll have a lunch or dinner with you, and if you win, I buy. But what I have a chance to do is actually take so much of my education and so much of the training and background and apply that. And in this case, we actually have a company that it's really one of those companies that could change the world. And it is taking plastic and recycling it back into oil and gas that's reusable and then goes back into the economy as usable gas, usable oil. And as you can imagine, the cycle, and that's why they call it the recyclable economy or the circular economy, is so it's alive and well. And this company, New Hope Energy, is one that we're working with and just having a ton of fun with.
Okay, so tech, and when you work with a client like that, what are some of the first things you look at when you're trying to come up with a valuation?
Yeah, so we have our standard punch list just like everybody else does, and what we're looking at is financials. We're going to look at your projections to see where do you think you're going to be going in the future? And how much different is that picture than where you've been in the past? And then, of course, we're going to look out there into the marketplace and go, all right, what other companies, maybe private ones, have done what you're doing or have pieces of what that company looks like that maybe have been in a transaction? So we'll take a look at those. And then perhaps there's even publicly traded companies that have some, I will say, indication of what a value could be. And then we'll take a look at those and see how much those could be impactful to the overall company's value as well. So again, we sit down and we say, yeah, the financials, historical financials, the projections, and let's talk about your industry. And that's where we get to learn. And that sense of curiosity is piqued, grows, and expands.
So let's suppose you have a business owner who's trying to minimize his or her taxes, and so they're spending as much as they can possibly spend, so they're not giving it to Uncle Sam. You have to be the guy who comes in and says, okay, wait, the private planes, the yacht, right?
So Jeff, I'm going to hopefully not infringe on any trademarks, but we call it the planes, trains, and automobiles discussion.
Yes.
We've valued them all. We've seen every single one. I should probably add wineries in there. There's some other fun stuff. The lake houses. As you can imagine, there's a number of things that we'll see that will show up, and we'll go, okay, so is that an operating asset? Do you actually really need that winery to run this? Or is this really what we could call a non-operating asset? And potentially you could sell that off or move that, you know, John Deere tractor collection over here
right.
Off the balance sheet of the company. So I say that tongue in cheek, but we did do a valuation where we actually valued a railroad small spur line in central Indiana because they used it for grain operating. I tell you, I have the best job in the world. Who ever in the world thought that when I was an MBA, I'd be able to go and value a train?
All right, so tell us your journey. How did you get here?
Well, it's never a straight path. And I tell the story and I go back to 1988 and really 1987 when the stock market crash just kind of impacted me and what I wanted to do. I always thought I wanted to be an investment banker. I looked at Wall Street and I said, that's where I belong. And I had a number of people tell me, yeah, it's going to be tough to get there from Central Illinois. I didn't realize how tough it would be. And by the way, I've never been an investment banker. So the path wasn't straight. But the capital markets always had a very, very insightful part in my life and one of those things where I just, great intrigue. So when I looked at the capital markets, I'm like, I think maybe Wall Street is a different way and as an investment planner. But long story short, I came through to the valuation community through the capital markets, which isn't a typical path for a lot of people. But understanding that sometimes I feel like the Forrest Gump of the financial markets because I was there for the 1997 currency crisis. I had a front row seat to the 2001 bubble, internet bubble. And then I was an asset-backed securities analyst during the liquidity crisis and the housing market crisis that then led to the liquidity crisis. So as you can imagine, taking from those experiences and drawing out of those tough times and then all the great times I've had, those become part of everything we do as far as an analysis. Literally, when you're working on biotech companies or you're working on recycling companies and you go, wow, I remember that senior level biology course. I wish I remembered all of those nerves coming out of the back of the skull. Literally, I've had those conversations with myself before. So that's why I go back and say, if you want to use virtually every bit of education you've ever had, business valuation is the place for you.
And you already described that you've been through several ups and downs in the market. Is it better to sell during kind of the rah-rah peaks than it is the valleys?
As I used to tell my MBA students, the best way to start the answer is it depends. It depends on who you're selling to. I will tell you that at different cycles, there's been more opportunities to sell your company to, say, an ESOP plan, an employee stock ownership program. Today, private equity has a tremendous amount of interest in private companies that fit the bill. There's some significant characteristics that they're looking for. And that has been an incredible run for a number of private companies for quite a while. So where we're at in the cycle, it really depends on where the best place is at, because sometimes selling the company at the low isn't what you would necessarily want to do, but it is, presents an opportunity at that time that may not present itself again. So yeah, you always want to be selling the company at extraordinarily high multiples where, you know, perhaps interest rates are low and everything just seems to be rose-colored and moving forward. And so, yeah, that's great. You may never ever get a valuation at that level again. But that doesn't necessarily mean you won't get a good valuation in the future.
So one last question. Interest rates. With the Fed tightening, how does that play a role in what you do?
A direct impact. Today's dollars are being, you know, priced, well, I should say future dollars are being priced today at a higher level of interest rates, which essentially makes them worth less today. What we do when we're looking at the projections, the discounted cash flow is a valuation methodology that we use frequently. It makes future dollars, all of the things held constant, the old ceteris paribus, all other things held constant, that will reduce the value of a dollar today that you would be receiving in the future. So these interest rates have really ramifications across a number of different places in the valuation. Instantaneously, the stock market almost reprices. So multiples can compress right away. So now you have two valuation methodologies that are being adversely impacted by rising interest rates. So it definitely has an impact. And then the overall business economy and the overall business environment. As rising interest rates, it's funny how this all kind of cycles through. And now it starts impacting the macroeconomic environment, which impacts your revenue stream. And you can see how this starts to feed on one another and has a very dramatic impact.
Thank you so much for coming on the show. We're going to end with the website, Jeffrey Brewster. Website there is on the screen, objectivecp.com. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you so much.
That's it for now. We'll see you next time.